Hey world, hey universe. So we just discussed about some of the reflections and revelations that all of us had or shared over the last week after the loss of a loved one. And so I'm going to continue sharing about this process of grieving, you know, because it's very important for us to understand these emotions, like how do each one of us handle these emotions. Or rather, sharing of my experience about how I managed to handle this sort of a grief, which was indeed a very, very deep one, I should say. So the first thing I did is, of course, like, you know, the entire office, we sort of postponed all the activities, it's like a way to honor her, honor our beloved Raji. So we postponed all the activities, and my diary had never looked so empty like that, like with no to-dos. And my loved ones at work and home, they empathized with me so much. They just let me stay very gloomy and confused. And I took time to reach out to people, and people reached out to me, and which was indeed very, very soothing and comforting. This whole process of, you know, going back and forth about the sort of beautiful memories that all of us had with Raji, and then just discuss about it. It was, of course, like grieving. It was emotionally overwhelming, but at the same time, it was also allowing us to sort of explore these emotions and how we were able to cope up with these emotions. Okay, the second thing is a new practice that I had started in after this particular loss, which is usually I start and end my day contemplating in silence. Okay, but I added an additional practice, which is just to read these words out loud, which is, my body will surely die sometime, but I don't know how or when. Of course, the statement looks very sort of negative even to people, but then just think about the profound reality behind the statement, which is, my body will surely die sometime, but I don't know how or when. This is called contemplating on our own death, and this was taught to me by Miss Anushka in the 10% happier. There's a meditation app called 10% happier, and there was a blog. So I saw, as part of this blog, this meditation teacher had shared this practice, and I really found this practice to be very useful, because the only thing that we are sure of is that all of us will face death at some point in life. But when we reinforce this thought, like, you know, that, you know, this body, this physical realm is something that's going to just go away from us, it takes away the element of fear, it brings in more purpose, and it helps us to focus on the most meaningful things in life. Like, you know, not on superficial things, not on urgent things, not on things that feed our ego, but our true inner self. And when I started to do this practice, like, it's of course a very recent practice, but the moment I start to do this practice, like, just thinking about this fact that, you know, this body will anyway go away from me at some point of time, but I just don't know how or when, it helps me to stay grounded, and it immediately, you know, kind of brings me back to the present moment, letting me know the most important things that I need to do. So, you know, my checklist now has got a full rework done. Like, I've removed so many things from the list, and I'm, of course, it's all, like, you know, working, or rather trying out as what sort of practice is going to work for you. But this one, I should say, like, has helped me to focus on the most meaningful things, at least over the last 10 days. For example, like reaching out to loved ones, establishing deep connections, it has become like number one in the list, and because nothing can replace this human bonding, right? And so this is the second thing, okay, which is about contemplating on our own death as a mode to cope up with grief and also to cope up with the fear of death. The third thing is, I faced certain situations which was emotionally draining during this week of grieving, which was like, you know, of course, when it comes to interacting with people, there are people who are comforting and there are people who, as I told in earlier episodes, who would also emotionally drain you, right? So I sort of had interactions with some of these people who were completely apathetic, like, you know, there's no emotions. They were very hostile and sounding hostile. There's some lack of kindness and understanding of this whole process, okay? I was like, you know, why would people be like this, especially in such a situation where you need more kindness, more compassion, more understanding, more coming together? And I'm like, okay, so I went in and asked Raji, because usually that's what I do, right? Whenever I don't know how to handle my emotions, I would just go and just, you know, bombard her with my emotions. So I just asked her deep inside, so how do you want me to respond? And she never likes reacting. And what she would have told is this, basically, okay? People behave from their own level of maturity or the level of consciousness that they are at. And there's nothing personal about this, Riz. They are just behaving from their own level of awareness, okay? And so you don't take this personal. And she would have also told me that maybe they have a different perspective about this situation and they never have an intention to hurt you. So stay calm, dear, and don't stress yourself, because stress is the killer. And this is what she would have told me, because it was important for me to gain that perspective at that moment rather than again to kind of sort of drain my emotions when I already, you know, I'm in a state of emotional overwhelm. So this was sort of reparenting my own self, like how Raji used to do for me. Now, of course, I have an option to just talk to her in the sense of like soul to soul connection. And of course, Mahatriya coincidentally said in the last week's satsang that the proof of spiritual evolution is the manifestation of peace, is the manifestation of inner peace. So like the Kung Fu Panda that says, you know, inner peace. I think all these experiences are sort of, you know, helping us to become more mature, more sort of face all kinds of people and still stay in an emotionally balanced condition, right? And then the next thing I did is, of course, thanks to many of you who motivated me to do it. Many of you, in fact, committed to do it, which was what I shared towards the end of that last episode, where, you know, Raji's husband had requested all the women to take care of their health. So I got an entire blood workup done, sorts of like the inflammatory markers and things like that. And of course, the results have come in, and thank God, of course, out of 100, you will have like 5-6 which are back. But always it's important to sort of work on preventative strategies, right? So I think self-awareness and preventative strategies are two most important keys to staying at the top of your emotional and physical well-being. And there's so much beauty in this sort of agony. Like, you know the impermanence, you know that there is uncertainty, and then, like, you know, when it comes to this physical realm, but still you want to take care of this temple, which is the holy house of our spirit. And this is the best yogic practice that someone can do to honor our loved ones. Because what is the point in staying in fear? It's important to use fear as the positive feedback, and love is the only antidote to fear. And self-love is not selfishness. Self-love is not selfishness, okay? And the last thing I want to tell you is this, like, of course, Mahatriya in the last week's satsang gave this, gave the answer for the question that many of us had in our minds, which is the question is not about when we die, it's about how we live, okay? It's about deriving inspiration when we lose our loved ones. It's all about deriving inspiration from everything they did right in their life. Okay, and learn from their mistakes and not to repeat it. It's always, you know, he said it's always easy to put out a spark when it is still a spark, rather than letting it become a forest fire and then trying to kind of blow it off, right? And so I'm sharing the link of his satsang also in the comment section, so you can just go and listen to his satsang. He almost nailed everything, as he just does every single time. Okay. And then lastly, it's the dealing of the emotional overwhelm. Of course, like being in healthcare, we know We know about this model, Dr. Kubler-Ross, the great Swiss psychiatrist, had proposed about the different stages of grief, where you go through phases of denial, where you first sort of, you know, you just don't want to accept anything, then you become angry, and then you start to bargain, like, you know, I would do anything to get back my loved one. And then, you know, you move into depression, and finally there's no other way other than to accept that loss. And these emotions sometimes come all sorts of like mixed up and messed up together. But what I am sort of doing now is the four-step process that spiritual teacher Koya Webb has proposed, which is acknowledging and accepting that yes, I'm emotional, I'm angry about this thing. And then the second thing is to use forgiveness as a weapon, which is like most of us now have this sort of guilt and shame, like I should have done this, I should have done that. Like the COVID-19 situation has not allowed us to even go and do the sort of, you know, regular funeral processes. We didn't sort of get time to spend with her. So all sorts of emotions are going on. But then it's important to forgive us and then come out of these sort of guilt and shame, because unless we do that, we will not be able to move forward with really like what is next, right? So the next is the practice of gratitude, which is I am currently grateful for the peace with which Raji handled the entire process, okay? Because I never saw her becoming really emotionally agitated. I mean, she had intense sense of peace within her, and then she had tremendous awareness also about what was coming through, and that's what I'm sensing now. And I really feel a deep sense of gratitude for that sort of peace and awareness that she possessed. So the first thing is to acknowledge and accept the grief. The second is to forgive our own self for all the sort of emotions that are coming through, or for things that we didn't get to do. The third thing is to be very grateful for what really, you know, is really worth feeling grateful. And then the last is to set intentions, because it's important to set intentions to move forward, like let our lives be led in honor of these souls and not to lose ourselves in the chaos around, because the whole world is so chaotic outside. I mean, I can see that. So it's important for us to use our breath as an anchor or as a tool to stay grounded, because that's something that's telling us that you are alive and kicking. And I really hope that this sharing of my reflections about the impermanence of life, the practice of contemplating about our own death, the four-step process to handle grief, I think it echoed with many of you as well. And I'm so happy to be the voice of the collective consciousness that we are, that we've gathered around today. Okay, so keep praying, keep the hopes up all the time. Believe in miracles, okay? Believe in miracles. And I'm sending you all like big, big virtual hugs, because this is really helping me. This sort of love that you are all spreading through your comments, through your messages, it's really helping many of us. And I'm so, so grateful for being able to express myself to this beautiful community. And I love you all so much. And until I see you next week, please keep sharing your experiences, your love, and signing off with infinite love, gratitude, and bliss. This is yours, Riz. Let the soul speak.